This is Toru Ozawa. I'm happy to conclude this ICM as the chairman. The first impact lecture in this session will be done by Professor Lo San Hamon from École Normale Supérieure of France. She's very famous, but I would add a trivial remark that she was awarded by Curie Prize by French Ministry of Research and Education and the French Academy of Sciences. Recently she was elected to the French Academy of Sciences. Okay, today, the title of our talk today is From Molecular Dynamics to Kinetic Theory and Hydrodynamics.
I would like first to thank the scientific committee and especially the PDE's panel for the invitation and the opportunity to give this lecture here, even though it seems that my talk has disappeared from the program on the website, but still I will give a talk. And actually it is a joint talk with Isabel Gallagher, who will speak right after. So in this first part, what I would like to do is to introduce the problem that we will consider, and then to try to point out the main difficulties for the mathematical treatment of this problem, and to give some partial landmark results on this problem. And then in the second part, I think that Isabel will focus on a more precise result that we have obtained recently with Thierry Bodineau, and which is actually a complete solution of this problem in some particular case. Okay, so let me first explain what I'm interested in. So the question that we will consider comes actually from fluid mechanics, and it's quite natural. So as you probably know, there are many ways to describe a fluid, especially a gas like in this room. So the first way to consider this gas is just to consider all elementary particles and then to write the dynamics of this system just by writing a system of ordinary differential equation for each position and velocities of each elementary particle. So you end up with a very complex system of ODEs. And actually, in general, you don't use this kind of system because it's really too complicated. And you replace this kind of system by some macroscopic description. So just considering the fluid as a continuous medium. Okay. So then there is a natural question to know whether or not these two kinds of description give you the same kind of behavior and the same dynamics. Okay. So actually what we would expect is that these hydrodynamic models are just an approximation of this complete description here as in the limit when the number of particles tend to infinity. Okay, and so you expect essentially this macroscopic description just to be an approximation. Okay, so there are really a few partial results in this direction. Due essentially to Olav, Radan, Yao, and Quastel, and probably some collaborators. But an important point to be noted is that they need to add some noise on this system of particles. So this is not their starting point is not the Hamiltonian system, but the Hamiltonian system plus some random noise. Okay, and then just essentially using say arguments like the law of large numbers or the central limit theorem, as was explained a little bit yesterday by Bourdin, they can derive the macroscopic models. Okay, so here what we intend to do is just a little bit different because we don't want to add any noise on the system here, And the randomness is expected to come only from, say, the uncertainty on the initial data. Okay, so we will replace the noise on the dynamics here by just some randomness on the initial data. Okay, then following the suggestion of Hilbert in his sixth problem, we just introduce an intermediate level of description, which is known as kinetic model. So, which is of course related to the work of Boltzmann. So this description essentially is the same level of description as the macroscopic description here. So you consider all the position and velocity of the particles. Okay, so you just look at the level of elementary particles, but instead of looking at all position and all velocities of all particles, you just look at the statistical repartition of this position and velocities. Okay, so this is the same level of description, but here you have a deterministic system of ODEs, and here you have just, say, some statistical description. Okay, so essentially what I would like to do is to explain you a little bit more in detail the main features of this kind of model here, and then I will try to explain the connection with both other models, so this connection here, which is called a low density limit, and the connection here, which is the fast relaxation limit, so the connection between the Boltzmann equation and the fluid equation. Okay, so this is essentially what I would like to do now. So let me just start with basic features about the Boltzmann equation. So as I told you, this is a statistical description, meaning that the object that you consider is a probability. Okay, so this probability is just the probability of finding a particle, say, of position x and velocity v at time t. Okay, and of course you have to to divide by the total number of particles to get a probability. So this kind of function here you cannot observe by with physical tools, but you can use this function here to compute all the parameters that you can observe. So, for instance, the density, the macroscopic density, is just the integral of this function f respect to v. So it just tells you how many particles you have at a fixed point x. Okay. Then the bulk velocity is the average of v against this probability here, and the temperature is just the variance of this distribution here. Okay, so you can essentially compute all the quantities you are interested in, all observable quantities, by taking average of this probability f. Okay, so this is the unknown that you are interested in. And now, what you would like to do, and what is really new, I think, in the work of Boltzmann, is that for the first time, actually, he wrote an equation for an evolution equation for probability. Okay, so essentially, in this evolution equation, what you would like to take into account are two phenomena. So the first one is just transport. So you just take one particle, and if there is no collision and no external force, it will just move in, according to straight lines with a constant uniform motion. Okay. And of course, if the velocity changes a little bit, then you replace this free transport by this differential equation here, that the derivative of the position is just the velocity. Okay, so this is the first phenomenon that you would like to take into account, is the transport. And then I will just focus on very simple gas. Of course, in writing, this is a little bit different, but say I will consider just a gas constituted of billiard balls. Okay, meaning that essentially, the velocity is not changed unless you have a collision. Okay, so then if you have two particles like this, so two billiard balls with velocity v prime and v prime 1, at some point they can collide, and then they are reflected according to this very simple law. So this is an elastic reflection, meaning that you have just you can compute v and v1 just in terms of v prime 1, which are the velocities before the collision, and the parameter, so the direction of x minus x1 at the point of collision. Okay, so this is just a simple computation. What you ask for is that both the momentum, so the total momentum, so the sum v prime plus v prime 1 is conserved, so it's equal to v plus v 1, and that the kinetic energy, so the sum of v prime square plus v prime 1 square is equal to v square plus v 1 square. Okay, so these are just the law coming from the fact that you assume that each elementary collision is elastic. Okay, so you would like to have both these phenomena in your equation, and then you end up with this complicated thing. So I will try to explain a little bit. I know that this looks like a little bit like a monster, but it's not so complicated. So you would like to write the equation for f. So just to assume for the moment that the right hand side is zero. So here you have dtf plus v grad xf is equal to zero. And you can check that if you take f of tx minus vt v, then you can differentiate with respect to t and you obtain that it is exactly equal to zero, meaning that f is just transported along this characteristics of the transport, the free transport. Okay, so this first part here, if you just put zero here in the right hand side, you obtain that this is exactly the fact that the particles are transported with constant uniform, with constant velocity. Okay, so this is for the first part. And then you have this second part, which takes into account the fact that you have collision. So here you have a positive term, which is called game term. So you see that you can increase the number of particles of velocity v just by having a collision between a particle of velocity v prime and a particle of velocity v prime 1. And then possibly they can create a new particle of velocity v. Of course, there is no new particle, but there is a new particle of velocity v. Okay, so you can increase this quantity here, so the number of particles with position x and velocity v, just having this kind of collision. And you can decrease this number if you have a collision between a particle of velocity v and a particle of velocity v1, and then they are deflected and you have one particle of velocity v which just disappears. Okay? So this is essentially what is expressed by this term here. And then you have this, what is called here, the collision cross-section, which tells you what is the statistical repartition of this deflection. Okay? So of course you have to count the number of particles which are which collide. And then you have this parameter here, which is due to the fact that you have normalized f to be a probability, so the integral of f is equal to 1. So this parameter here just encodes essentially the density of particles. Okay, so you have a normalized everything, f is a probability, and then you have an additional parameter here, which encodes the density. You see that if the density is large, then you expect to have a great number of collisions, okay, which is something which is just natural. Okay, so you have this equation here, which is a bit complicated, but still you can understand what is the meaning of each term. Okay, so this equation has been written for the first time by Boltzmann at the end of the 19th century, but as we will see, it has some important features which makes this equation really different from the Hamiltonian system, which is supposed to describe the same dynamics. Okay, so this is the point that I would like to discuss right now. So here is a computation which I will try to explain a little bit. So the first thing is that you have assumed that all the particles are identical. Okay, so in particular here, V and V1 play a completely symmetric role. Okay, you can just exchange the number of particle 0 and particle 1, and then you just exchange V and V1. So if you integrate here with respect to V and V1, you see that this quantity here is symmetric, this quantity here is symmetric, this one also. So you can just exchange V and V1. Okay, just because the particles are exactly identical. So this is the first thing. And there is another thing that you have assumed that these collisions are essentially reversible. So if you start from particles with velocity v prime and v prime 1, you can get this particle of velocity v and v1. But conversely, if you start from particle of velocity v and v1, you can obtain by some essentially other collision particles of velocity v prime and v prime 1. Okay, so you can just reverse the dynamics okay, if you have already played to billiard, you know that if you just change the velocity in minor, you just go back to the initial configuration. Okay, so because of these two properties, you have you can use these symmetries, so between V and V1, and between the pair VV1 and V prime one in the integral here. So Q of FF is just the collision integral. And then you see that this is just 1 over 4 times phi of V plus phi of V1. So this is the symmetry respect between V and V1. And then you can write minus phi of V prime 1, just because this quantity here, you have to change the sign if you change VV1 and V prime of V prime 1. Okay, so this is just a very simple computation. Okay, but this simple computation has very important consequences. The first one, that if you take phi to be 1, okay, you have that 1 plus 1 minus 1 minus 1 is equal to 0, and then you obtain that this integral, okay, is always 0. Okay, so if you integrate the right-hand side of my equation against 1, you obtain 0. Okay, and this is the same actually if you take phi to be equal to v, because v plus v1 is equal to v prime plus v prime 1, because each collision preserves the kinetic momentum, and the same for the kinetic energy. Okay, so if you integrate Q of FF against 1 or V square, you obtain that it's exactly 0. Okay, so you can integrate the previous equation, so the equation here. You just take this equation, integrate respect to against 1 V and V square. So all this right hand side is 0, and what you obtain is this equation here, this system of equations. So this tells you essentially that the density. The total the density is preserved, okay, with the flux here, which depends on the bulk velocity. Then here, this is the conservation of kinetic momentum, and this is the conservation of kinetic energy. Okay, so this is something which is really natural because you assume that each collision preserves both the number of particles, the kinetic momentum, and the kinetic energy. So in average, you preserve all these quantities. Okay, so this is. A first important feature from a physical point of view, that you have this conservation here. Now you have another important fact, that now if you take phi to be log of f, okay, so here you have log of f plus log of f of v1, so this is just the log of f of v1, just because the logarithm is additive, okay, and the same here, this is a logarithm of phi of f of v prime, f of v prime 1. Okay, and then if you use the fact that the logarithm is an increasing function, you obtain that this quantity here, if you integrate Q of FF against the log of F, has a sign. Okay, so of course this is something which is really important in this Boltzmann dynamics. That so if you integrate, if you multiply the equation by log of F and integrate, okay, so the right hand side you have a sign, and then for the left hand side you have the same sign. Okay, and it tells you that this quantity here, which is just the integral of f log of f, is a quantity which is a Lyapunov functional for the evolution. Okay, so these really simple symmetries on the collision integral tells you that you have the conservation of, say, what you expect, kinetic momentum, kinetic energy, and density, and the Lyapunov functional for the evolution. Okay, and this feature is really different from the microscopic dynamics that you can describe by the Hamiltonian system, because this tells you that the Boltzmann dynamics is not reversible. Okay, so I at the very beginning I have these three models, so I say that essentially the Boltzmann equation should be essentially the same description as the Hamiltonian system, but of course it is not, because one is reversible and the other one, this Boltzmann dynamics, is not. Okay, so this is the first important thing. And actually, this is related to what is called in physics the second principle of thermodynamics. Okay, so except that the entropy of mathematicians is just the opposite of the entropy of physicists, just, okay. So now, so you have this entropy which decreases, and now there is a natural question: what happens for very long times? Okay. So what you can compute are just the minima or the maxima, depending on the convention that you choose, of this functional here. But under the constraints that the integral of f, the integral of fv, and the integral of fv square has to be conserved. Okay, so if you just forget about everything rigorous and just do a formal computation, then you obtain that the derivative of this functional here, which is just the log of f, is a linear combination of 1, v, and v square. Okay, so the minima of the entropy, or the maxima, I don't remember what condition I use here. So you obtain that the log of f is a combination like this, so a polynomial of 1, v, and v square. Okay, so you expect that in the limit, when the time will tend to infinity, you expect that you will obtain a maxima of the entropy, and this maxima is just what is called a Maxwellian distribution, or essentially a Gaussian, okay, because it has been predicted by Maxwell that equilibria for this kind of evolution are given by Gibbs measure. Okay, so this is. This is essentially the main feature of this collision kernel. So maybe just a last comment. You see that this computation here, I have essentially forgotten about the transport. So if you consider a regime where the collision are much faster than the transport, then you expect that for any time, you should be close to a local Maxwellian. Okay, so this will explain the relation with, say, hydrodynamics. But I will come to this right now. So the first thing I would like to discuss now is the transition between this statistical description, so the Boltzmann equation, and hydrodynamics. Okay, so this is the first thing that I would like to discuss. So, this is exactly what I told you some minutes ago. So if you look either for very long times, either or in the case where you have a density which is large, so this parameter alpha, which was in front of the collision kernel, is large. Okay, so in this kind of regime, you expect that actually the collision will be much faster than the transport. So essentially you can, in first approximation, just forget about the transport, and then look at just the process, the relaxation process, which is associated to collisions. Okay, and then you obtain that the density should be close to a local Maxwellian, meaning that this Maxwellian, so the parameter here, the macroscopic parameter, so the density, the temperature, and the bulk velocity depend on t and x. Okay, so you just look at this dynamics. You have very large number of collisions, so locally close to each point x you have a relaxation, and you expect the density to be close to some equilibrium like this. Okay, so now if you want to describe the state of the gas, the only thing that you need is to describe the dynamics of capital R, capital T, and capital E. Okay, so you are just you can just focus on this parameter here, which are observables, and which are functions only on the time and the position. There is no more velocity here. Okay, so the dependence with respect to velocity is just given by the Gaussian, and then you have just to characterize this. So this is a d plus 2 dimensional system for R, T, and E. Okay, so if now if you plug this ansatz in the conservation which are written here, so you just replace f by the Maxwellian, the local Maxwellian, then you obtain a system of partial differential equation for R, U, and T, which is exactly a hydrodynamic approximation of the Boltzmann equation. Okay, so this is essentially the relation between, say, in general, between the Boltzmann equation and hydrodynamics. Now, the Euler equation that you obtain with this simple thing is one approximation, and actually can try to go a little bit further and to obtain approximation of a higher order. And this is exactly what we need to do if you want to obtain equation like the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, so maybe for if there are some probabilities here, the idea is that the Euler equation, which are a hyperbolic system of PDEs, is obtained, say, like the law of large number for this system, for the Boltzmann equation, and then the Navier-Stokes equation would be the equivalent of the central limit theorem. So you just look at the fluctuation around this average. So the average just satisfied the Euler equation, and then you are interested in the fluctuation around this average. So the problem is that in general the Euler equation are very complicated because you expect some non-smooth behavior due to shocks and so on. So here the only average that I will look at are just equilibrium. So here I will look at some fluctuation, okay, some small fluctuation around a global equilibrium. Okay, so I take I suppose that at least initially the density F is just a global Maxwellian, so say center the unit Gaussian, just with a little fluctuation of order 1 over alpha. Okay, and then if I want to see something, I have to just delay time. Okay, it's at first order, I see just that everything is at equilibrium. But then at next order, I can what I would like to do is essentially to find the equivalent of the central limit theorem. And then, so for this after this time rescaling, we expect that this function f should be well approximated by a solution of a diffusion equation. Okay, so let me explain a little bit more the formal thing to obtain this diffusive approximation. So the first thing that you can observe that, so remember that alpha is large. So if you just multiply this equation by 1 over alpha, this term should be small because like 1 over alpha squared. Okay, this term should be small because it's like 1 over alpha. And so what you obtain as the first approximation is that Q of f, f is equal to 0. So f should be essentially Maxwellian. But as I look at the fluctuation here, this would be a fluctuation of Maxwellian, so something like this. Just a linear combination of 1, v, and v squared. Okay, so this is the first approximation, is just, say, the linearization of Maxwellian. Okay? And then if I look at the order, the next order, you see that I can linearize this term here. So what I obtain is that the first correction would be this term here coming from the transport, okay, and then the other term comes from the quadratic term coming from this integral here. Okay, so I have that the first approximation is just this Maxwellian here, and then the second order approximation, you have two terms, one which comes from the transport here, and one which comes from the nonlinearity. Okay, so of course this computation has to be done a little bit carefully, but essentially this is what you expect. Okay. Then you can do exactly the same thing as in the previous transparency, and you can replace g in the conservation of mass, momentum, and kinetic energy by this and that here, and what you obtain is exactly the Navier-Stokes equation. Okay, so you have a theorem. Actually, you have many. I give one theorem here, but there are many results for this hydrodynamic limit. So if you start, if you consider the dynamics for the Boltzmann gas, so you assume that the inverse mean free path or density is equal to alpha, which corresponds to the alpha between in front of the collision operator, and so close to a global equilibrium. So you assume that, say, the initial fluctuation is of order one, okay. And then you look at the fast relaxation limit, but you have this diffusive time rescaling, so you have rescaled time by this factor alpha. Then you can prove that the bulk velocity of the gas, so u, which is just the integral of g v dv, is close to the Lorentz solution of the Navier-Stokes equation. So the Navier-Stokes equation are just this incompressible equation. So you have a different term here. So first of all, you have that the divergence of u is equal to zero, which corresponds to the incompressibility constraint. Okay, the fact that your gas cannot be deformed. And then you have the equation for the evolution of u, which is dtu plus this term which corresponds to transport, then this term which is the pressure which is just the Lagrange multiplier associated to this constraint here is equal to nu Laplace of u, which is exactly the viscosity. Okay, so this is this viscosity. I think that Isabel will explain a little bit more in the linear case. This corresponds to the diffusive process, or to a Brownian motion actually. So this is really the fact that you have this central limit theorem and this diffusion at second order. Okay. So of course this limit is not really the we will see that this is not exactly the strong limit of u, because actually you have this mean velocity here plus a very fast oscillating component, which is known as acoustic waves, and which is known from physicists, of course. Acoustic waves are something which are just correspond to sound. Okay, so you have a complete description of the asymptotics in the limit when alpha tends to infinity. So maybe I would like just to say a couple of words or some hints about the proof. Of course, I will not prove this and neither explain the functional framework to prove this kind of theorem. But I would like to just mention some important facts. So the first one is that exactly as when you want to construct solution for the Navier-Stokes equation, the important thing is that you have some a priori bounds which come. So in the case of the Navier-Stokes equation, the a priori bounds come from the energy inequality. Okay, so here the equivalent of the energy inequality, the entropy inequality. So you have an inequality like this, which comes from the fact that you have this Lyapunov functional for the Boltzmann equation. So you have two quantities, and this is just due to the scaling of the equation. So a first quantity here, which is the relative entropy, which measures essentially the distance between the fluctuation and the global Maxwellian. And then you have this other quantity here, which is the entropy dissipation, which is essentially the integral of Q of F, F log of F, which tells you essentially gives you some control on the distance between F and the local Maxwellian. Okay, so what is crucial in this proof, the fact that you control these two quantities here, so you can prove that the fluctuation G is essentially something which is bounded in L2, okay, up to some small remainder. So the functional framework is a little bit complicated, but say essentially you can prove that this fluctuation is of order one. So if you start from a small fluctuation around the global equilibrium, for all times you will have a small fluctuation around the global equilibrium. Okay, so this is due to this bound on the relative entropy here, and then you have this other bound coming from the entropy dissipation, which tells you that G is actually very close to this local Maxwellian. Okay, so which is the linearized version of the local Maxwellian. So rho plus u dot v plus theta v square minus d rho 2, up to some remainder, which is which exactly corresponds to this expansion here. So this is this term here, and then you have some other things. Okay. So now, if you just plug this ansatz, okay, so just use the formal arguments and plug this ansatz into conservation, you will obtain that for fixed alpha, essentially the moment, so the bulk velocity, will satisfy this equation up to a small remainder. Okay, so for fixed alpha, you have this kind of equation for u, plus something which is of the order of 1 over alpha. Okay, and then what we want to prove that you can take limits as alpha tends to infinity, that is that this equation is stable under the weak convergence. Okay, so all the problems to prove the hydrodynamic limit, to prove the stability of this kind of equation. Okay, so the first thing, so you have only weak convergence, meaning that of course you cannot take limits in non-linear terms. Okay, you have this convection term, gradient of u square essentially, and you only know that u is bounded in L2, but this doesn't tell you that u is converged strongly in L2. Okay, so the problem now is to know whether or not you have strong compactness in L2 for the bulk velocity. So the first thing is that you can prove that you have a little bit of regularity with respect to space variables. Okay, And the point, well, the important point, I think mentioned this morning by Cédric when speaking about the work of Benoît. So the important thing is that if you look at all the terms that you have in the equation, what you can prove is that essentially V grad X G is something which is bounded. Some very awful space, but still this quantity here is bounded. Okay? So of course this doesn't tell you that G is smooth respect to X. Because you see that you can imagine that the derivative respect to X can be essentially orthogonal to V. Okay? So there is a zone here of the phase space for which you have no regularity. Okay? But actually if you look not at G but at average of G, so you just integrate G against a function which is smooth respect to V. Okay? So you can separate the integral in two terms. So a first term where essentially Xi, which is the Fourier mod of respect to X, is such that V dot Xi is small. But this zone here, this domain here is very small, so it contributes a little bit to the average. Okay? And then in this zone here, in the other domain, you have that V is not orthogonal to Xi. Okay? And then this equation tells you that G is smooth respect to X. Okay? So if you don't look at G but at average of G, this kind of thing, so of course you have to optimize all the parameters and so on, but this kind of argument tells you that the moment of G, in particular U, is smooth respect to X. Okay? So this tells you that there is no spatial concentration. Okay, so this is the first thing. You have no strong compactness on U, because we will see that respect to time there are some problems, but at least respect to X, you have some kind of compactness. Okay? And now there is a dependence respect to T. So if you write the equation, actually what you obtain is something like this. So you obtain that dt rho plus alpha divergence of u is equal to zero and some other equation. So you see that the equation that you obtain for u is very similar to the Navier-Stokes equation up to this term here. So you have all these terms here. And I recall that alpha is a large parameter. So you see that the derivative respect to t of rho, u and theta is not bounded. It's something like of the order of alpha. Okay, so what is just the interpretation from the physical point of view, just the fact that you have very fast oscillation like this respect to time. Okay, so now you have to take the limits of some products like u square, but now you have an oscillation like sine of alpha t for u. Okay, and you know that if you just look at the limit of sine alpha t to the square, this is not the same as the limit of sine of alpha t to the square. Okay, so because of this oscillation, possibly you have not the convergence that you would like to prove. Okay, so you need here to use what is called compensated compactness to prove that actually this acoustic oscillation have no interference, no constructive interference. Okay, so they are this oscillation of course exists in the system, but they cannot create they cannot contribute to the mean motion. Okay, so there is a this is a computation which is just an algebraic computation, which is just something that you get to, it's not something which is complicated, but you have to check that essentially the particular algebraic structure of the nonlinear term here is compatible with the particular equation, particular wave equation, which describe the oscillation. Okay, so these are the two important points of the proof. So proving the smoothness respect to X and proving that these acoustic waves will not contribute to the mean motion. Okay? So that's all that we'll say about this transition between the kinetic equation and the hydrodynamics. And I have a couple of minutes to describe the other transition, so from the microscopic system to the Boltzmann equation, and I know that Isabel will tell you a little bit more about this. So. But, okay, so now my starting point is the system of n particles, okay, which are just hard spheres, okay, so epsilon here is just the size of the sphere, and n is the number of sphere. And what I say that essentially the transport and the collision process are the same time scale, so this is just a study of, say, average mean free path. So both phenomena are, say, almost balanced. If you have this scaling, so n times epsilon to d minus 1 is equal to alpha, and it's of order 1. Okay, so alpha, the parameter alpha that I have in the Boltzmann equation is just the limit of this this quantity here, so capital N times epsilon to d minus 1. It's just the cross-section if you just look at one particle in a lattice of particles of size epsilon, this is the probability of having a collision. Okay? So just a small remark that this scaling holds only for perfect gases, meaning that if you just look at the total volume occupied by the particles, it's something which is in the limit when n tends to infinity. And if this quantity here remains of order 1, you see that n times epsilon to the d is something which tends to 0. So the volume, total volume occupied by the particles is 0. And this is exactly what is called a perfect gas. So you have no excluded volume in the state relation. Okay, so now if you have this system, and what we would like to write to say is what is the equation for the empirical measure associated to the system of these nR spheres. Okay, so you can just write the Liouville equation for the density of n particles that integrate respect to all parameters except one, and then you obtain that the empirical measure here satisfies a collision transport equation, which looks like the Boltzmann equation. So this is not say the formal analysis tells you that essentially the empirical measure is almost a solution of the Boltzmann equation, except that instead of having dtf plus v grad xf is equal to something which depends on f squared, essentially, which is the Boltzmann equation, there's a dtf plus v grad xf is equal to something which depends on the joint probability of having two particles at the same point. Okay, tells you that the probability of having a jump in the velocity depends on the fact that you have two particles at the same point with the convenient velocities, and this probability of having two particles at the same point is a joint probability, and not in general this is not equal to the product of the probability. Okay, so this is just here, this is just a computation. Okay, so what is the approximation is the fact that you replace this joint probability just by expressing it in terms of the one particle distribution, so in terms of the empirical measure essentially. And this this is what is called the chaos assumption. So you assume essentially that the particles are independent for all times. Okay, so you assume that the particles which will collide are independent. Okay, so this is the main approximation, the main assumption in the Boltzmann theory, that the fact that the particles which will collide, of course the particles which have already collided, they are not more independent. Okay, but before the collision, you assume that each time that you will have a collision, the particles before the collision are independent. This is the main assumption. Okay, so this is really important that the Boltzmann equation is not a deterministic description of the dynamics, but just a statistical description. Okay, so this second principle of thermodynamics is not due to some irreversibility, due to some philosophical principle, but just the fact that you lose a part of the information by just having a statistical description of the collisions. Okay, so the kind of result that you can prove is the theorem of Lanford, which has been proved in 1975, I think. So you start from the dynamics, say on the torus, of n half spheres, and you assume that initially they are independent and identically distributed. Of course, this is a little bit exaggerated because they cannot be independent because they cannot overlap. But this is so they are almost independent. And you assume that they are distributed according to this kind of, so this initial distribution, F naught. You have this bound, so F naught is in some weighted functional space. Then in the Boltzmann-Brown limit, that is in the limit when n tends to infinity, which is the regime in which you expect the statistical description to be valid, and epsilon tends to zero, and you assume that you have this Boltzmann-Brown scaling, so n epsilon to d minus 1 equal to alpha. Then you the distribution of a typical particle is close to the solution of the Boltzmann equation, so which is exactly what the equation that I have written at the very beginning. The point is that this approximation here is true, is so odds on a time interval which depend on mu and beta. This is not really important here, but which also depend on alpha, and which actually is conversely proportional to alpha. Okay. So now, if you remember that you obtain the hydrodynamics in the limit when alpha tends to infinity, you see that this the validity of the Boltzmann equation would be just for time zero. Okay, so you cannot use this result plus the other result to go from the microscopic system of particles to hydrodynamics. Okay, just because here you have this restriction on time. So I have time's up. Okay, so I will stop here and I will let Isabelle just explain about the proof. Just let me conclude. So in the general case, this is just what I have explained. So here you have the low density limit, so Landfort theorem, but which holds only for a very short time. And then this can be proved. But this doesn't commute. Okay. So the case that will be explained by Isabelle is a little bit, not a little bit, it's clearly simpler. So the kind of system that we look at is just the case where you are very close to equilibrium. Okay, so you start from a gas which is almost at equilibrium, you just change a little bit the distribution of one particle, which is a one-tack particle. Then you have a mesoscopic description, so the equivalent of the Boltzmann equation, which is just a linear Boltzmann equation. And in this case, the important point that you can prove this limit here on a time interval which doesn't depend on alpha, or which depends slightly on alpha, but this time interval can tend to infinity as alpha tends to infinity, and so essentially everything commutes. So in the linear case, you can go from the microscopic description to the macroscopic description, but here the macroscopic description is not the Damier-Stokes equation, but just the heat equation or the Brownian motion. So I think I have to stop, and I thank you for your attention.
In regard to the transition from the Boltzmann description to the hydrodynamic description, so you described that in this fast relaxation field to announcement, you obtain the incompressible clause. But don't you think there should be some other limit from which you can get, let's say, the hydrodynamic description for an ideal gas which is monatomic?
So
monatomic ideal gas.
For sure, you have other possible limits.
With compressible.
So what you can obtain is either the compressible Euler equation, so which is hyperbolic, you have no diffusion, okay. Or you can obtain the incompressible Navier-Stokes. So what you cannot obtain is the compressible Navier-Stokes. Just because this Boltzmann equation is only for perfect gases, so you have no excluded volume in the state relation, and so you cannot be at the same time incompressible, at the same time compressible and viscous. Just because you have this relation, which is called the von Karman relation between the Mach number, the Knudsen number, and the viscosity, which tells you that it's not possible for a perfect gas to be both compressible and viscous. So you can obtain, of course, plenty of other equations, but not the compressible Navier-Stokes.
Okay, let's thank the speaker again. Here is a present from the ICM organizer.
Thank you.